Good morning. I'd just like to welcome everybody to service today. Glad to have everybody here. Hopefully everybody is doing well. Anybody need anything, please give us a call. Let's go ahead and open this service in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your goodness, Lord God. We thank you for your mercy. And Father, just the way that we know that you're here with us. Father, we pray that you would bless this time, bless this service, Lord God. We pray that your word would go forth with power. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you at home to stand with us as we worship the Lord together. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
An email that Pastor sent out on Saturday has the lyrics for the songs today. Also some important announcements. I'll share a couple of those here. He was asking if you would like to participate in communion for next Sunday. Do let us know, and the same as before, we'll get communion out to you, the elements. And it was decided the other day by the Diaconate Board that the quarterly meeting we would have had this last Sunday of April, it's just not possible to have it. So we're postponing all of that meeting to July. So we'll resume that quarterly meeting in July. With that, let's go to the Lord in prayer briefly. We'll continue with our service. Dear Lord, we just want to thank you for this day you've given us. We thank you, Lord, that as we are gathered together, still in your name here today, whether we're just watching this on YouTube or here present today, no matter what, Lord, we're united as your church body, praising you, Lord, for all the amazing things you've done with our church, even during this time. We thank you, Lord, for the remodeling efforts that are continuing here, so many improvements, Lord. We thank you for Pastor's leadership. Continue to watch over and protect the entire congregation, Lord. We just thank you for all the blessings you continue to pour out on us. We ask that you be with our missionaries out in the field, Lord, throughout so many countries, that, Lord, they may be facing a tougher time than us in the United States with this COVID-19. Please watch over and protect them, Lord. Help them to continue their mission of spreading the word for you, Lord. So again, we just thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's worship the Lord together. I invite you to stand and sing these songs from your heart to the Lord.
who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose blood is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King of all.
Amen.
Amen.
For those of you that are sitting back on your couches right now, boy, so glad to be in your living room. Gary was talking to me earlier today. He says one of the things that he misses is biscuits and gravy.
Amen.
Me too. Oh, might have to make some. So here we're gathered here today. We've been talking about our awesome God, right? And it's awesome to think about. It's awesome to think about God's goodness and how great He is, especially going through such a hard time as we're going through right now. People are anxious. They don't want to sit still. They want to get back to work. They want to get back with their family and friends and find something that's normal in their lives. And, you know, if you think about this series that we've been on, right? So it's about our awesome God, and it's to get us to a point of worship. God is worthy of worship, and we've gone through, 10 messages, or this one's the 10th, or a couple more. The first one was why we are here. We talked about God's glory, the Trinity. We just can't, something we can't fathom, unexplaining the unexplainable, God's holiness, right, His mighty hand, then we went through the three omnis, His omnipotence, His omniscience. Today, we're going to talk about His goodness. Right? I mean, can we really talk about God's goodness going through what we're going through? Is God really a good God? Amen. We say, matter of fact, the title of this message is God is good
all the time.
All the time, right? And all the time,
God is good.
That's the title of the message. So we've got a couple more messages left in the series of our awesome God, just so we can focus on who God is in our lives. Who God is, not just in our lives, but who He is, period, in the world that we live in. And as we learn more about Him, it should drive us to worship. It's the only logical outcome when you come face to face with the awesomeness of God, and that is worship. We're going to talk about something else next week, God's wrath. And then we're going to have a Mother's Day message. Sure wish we could all be together for Mother's Day. And then I'm going to finish up on God's faithfulness. There's still five more left that I have on God's awesomeness, but we'll put those off with something else when we come back to it later. And in this passage today, God is good all the time, right? And in Psalm 107:1, that's the head passage that I used. Psalm 107:1 reads, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever." Now, this theme of God's goodness is all throughout the Bible. 1 Chronicles 16:34 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good." Psalm 145:9 says, "The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made." I know you're flipping through real quick. Write them down. You can go back to them later. This is just a kind of an introduction. Psalm 34:8 says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him." So we see this in the Bible, but when we look at society and the world around us, we sometimes may come to doubt God's goodness. So we need to get a definition of what we're talking about, what the Bible talks about as God's goodness. The theological definition of God's goodness is His benevolence to His creation. Does that make it any clearer? Not really, right? His kindness exhibited towards all He has made. Break it down, it says this: God cares about everything that He has created. Right? I have said this many a times. Are we all children of God?
No.
Are we all the creation of God? Yes. Right? So God cares about everything that He has created. And what that tells us is that God is not indifferent. Right? It's not a take it or leave it type of God. It's not who He is. He's not undecided. Dualism says that God came, created, and left us to our own. That's a dualistic theology, and that is not how God is. God is not absent, as your atheist would like you to believe, that there is no God. So God's goodness, when we look at it, occupies great passages through the Old Testament and the New Testament. As a matter of fact, we even sang a song today, this morning, God is good, right? God is so good. And then it says, he's so good to me. Okay, well, that kind of limits it a little bit, because if you're listening this morning, and if you're one of the few here with me today, that limits it to just us. Well, see, in the world, there's two types of people. There's the lost, and there's the saved. So when we talk about the doctrine of God's goodness, we have to find out how it is displayed to both categories. Because if God was just good to his children and not to those of his creation, he wouldn't be a totally all good God. So the doctrine of God's goodness applies to both categories. And what we're going to do today is we're going to back up and we're going to take a look at God's goodness to both the saved and the unsaved. And I'm going to start with the unsaved. Right? The Bible tells us you're either lost or you're found. One of the two. So to the lost, write this verse down. Romans 2, chapter 4 says this: God's kindness leads you to repentance. Okay? And that comes right after Romans 1, 18 through 32, where God lays out the depravity of man and how he's given over and he's done all these things. And he comes back and he says that God's kindness is supposed to lead you towards repentance. See, because here's the truth. When you look at Romans 1, 18 through 32, you find that God punishes sinners. Anybody doubt that? I don't doubt that a bit. God punishes sinners. But judgment is sometimes delayed so that men and women have a time to repent. Let me tell you, if you're watching this and you're lost, every breath you take is a gift of God's goodness. If you're not saved, every breath you take is a sign of God's goodness and is meant to lead you to repentance. So here's seven signs of God's goodness to the unsaved. Now, there's many of them out there, but I've narrowed it down to seven. As a matter of fact, when I was looking and studying for this, there's a long list that I came up with, but here's seven of them, all right? Number one, God's sign of goodness to the unsaved is this, is that even creating them, knowing that they would rebel, God created them, knowing that we would rebel. You know, seven times inside of the book of Genesis, in the first few chapters, God called his creation good. As a matter of fact, the last time, he called it very good. Yet, God knew that men would turn away from him. God knew that the peace of paradise would be broken by sin. He knew Adam and Eve. He saw the pain and suffering that would come after, and yet still, he created them anyways. That's even you and I as believers. Or if you're, like I say, if you're not saved and you're watching this, God knew that we would rebel, and he created anyways. Let me ask you this. Would you create somebody knowing that they were going to rebel against you, that they were going to turn against you, that they would hate you, and then ultimately kill your son? Would you still create?
No.
In our humanity, no. But in God's goodness, he created anyways. Creation in the face of rebellion is a sign of God's goodness.
Amen.
Another thing here, the second thing that I've got here, is not only did God create, but that he continued to sustain people in spite of rebellion. Right? God does not execute the moment of a wicked person's sin. Could you imagine, before you were saved, that God would stop your life the moment you sin? And that is a mark of God's goodness to his creation, that he continued to sustain. It's like my father used to quote a famous comedian at one point in time, and he said, I brought you into this world, and I can take you out, and I can make another one to look just like you. I remember that. My dad used to tell me that. Even though none of my brothers looked just like me, they all looked different. But see, God continues to sustain our lives when we were even in the unbelieving state. Exodus 34:6 says this, is that God is slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. You see, if you look back, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, God could have stopped it right there and started over. But he didn't. He continued to sustain, even in the face of rebellion. The truth of the matter is that you and I, we have trouble showing kindness and goodness to those who are good. God did it in the face of evil. He shows it towards those who even hated him. And today, he continues to sustain the lives of people who are in an unregenerative state, that are unsaved. He continues to sustain their life. Third thing that I see here, how God's goodness is poured upon those who don't believe, is that he gives what we call common grace. All right? Common grace is God's general blessings that he gives to men and women, to the human race, no matter of your spiritual state. Right? Matthew chapter 5, verse 45. Matthew 5, 45, God says that the sun will rise and the rain will fall on the just and the unjust. There's no discrimination with God. That is a sign of God's goodness. Fourth thing, even to somebody who is lost, God puts a desire in their heart for him. Ecclesiastes 3:11 says that God has put eternity into the heart of every man. So anthropologists, those who study humankind and mankind, what they say is this, is that man by nature is incurably religious. You know, something drives us to seek meaning outside of ourselves. That's what they say. Right? As a matter of fact, French Pascal, I believe, he said this, that there's a God-shaped vacuum inside of every person. St. Augustine said it this way, "You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." And how awesome is that? Is that God, he created us knowing that we would rebel and still puts a desire in our hearts to find him at some point in some way. That's just natural. So do you get that? That for the atheist, their belief or their philosophy goes against nature. They have to deny themselves to be able to believe that there's no God, because God has put it in their heart. Fifth thing here. And this one here is important for me. He hears the prayers of the saved for the lost. James chapter 5, verse 16 says that the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, right? Or that the prayer of a righteous have much power. How it comes out. How many of us here today, whether you're here, you're listening, are there because somebody prayed for you? I know that I'm standing where I'm standing because my parents and my family prayed for me. I blame my mom for going to prison because she always used to pray that I would get caught. Boy, God answered that prayer. But she also prayed that there would be a preacher among one of her sons. God answered that prayer. You see, God hears the prayers of the saved for the lost. What does that tell you? Man, spend time on your knees for your lost friends and family. God is listening to your prayer for them. That is a mark of God's goodness. Sixthly, God allows the unsaved to see his power through the saved. Right? Let me explain that. If you can remember, if you're familiar with your Bible, if you remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, three godly men. Nebuchadnezzar wanted them to kneel before him, to bow down before him, but they refused to do it because they would worship nobody but God. So what did he do? Pumped that fiery furnace up, tossed them aside. And this is what we read in Daniel chapter 3, verses 28 through 29. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him and set aside the king's command and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree, any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb, and their houses laid in ruins, for there is no other God who is able to rescue in this way." This is a non-believing man that witnessed the power of God through these believers. And that's what he had to say. They came to the knowledge of God. What does that tell us today as believers, saints? We need to be bold in our witness. Right? We need to stand up for Christianity, for Christ who died for us. It's when the people get to see us, they're watching, right? Don't think they're not. They're listening to what you say, and they're watching how you live. That is a mark of God's goodness to the unsaved, how we live our lives. The last thing about the unsaved, God invites them to salvation through Jesus Christ. 1 Timothy 2:5 says that God desires all men to be saved and that Christ is the mediator. 2 Peter 3:9, this is what we read. "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." Man, God is inviting the unsaved. The last book in our Bible, Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, the bride, the Spirit and the bride say, "Come," and let the one who hears say, "Come," and let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who desires take the water of life without price. You see, God's plan of salvation is for all mankind. What's the most famous verse in the Bible that we all know? John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son." Right? That is a mark of God's goodness to the world. It's not just to the saved, but to everybody. God's goodness to the unsaved. So let's go ahead and see how God's goodness is to this, for those who have come to the saving knowledge of God. We sing this song, right? Count your blessings. Name them one by one, right? And at the end, you can see it. Look at what all God has done. You see, God's work and his power and his presence with believers is a mark of his goodness. Look at this. Everlasting life, the moment we believe. God doesn't make them wait. In John 6:47, Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life." Guess what? Our eternal salvation, our everlasting life, begins in this world. Awesome to know that even now, we have everlasting life. Second thing here, for believers, we have immediate access to God through prayer. And we're studying the book of Hebrews in our Bible study. We're going to come upon this verse. But Hebrews 4:16 tells us to come boldly before the throne of God so that we may receive grace in the time of need. What that means is that in the nick of time, right? When we pray, God is listening. Think about it. If you're someplace in another country, say, and they always say, "Oh, do you know Donald Trump?" "Yeah, no, he's our president." What would happen if you try to call him on the phone? "Hey man, I know Donald. Can you put me through to him?" Nope. But with God, man, as soon as we pray, God is listening, just like that. God is good. Third thing for believers that shows God's goodness is this, is that he answers prayer. But not all of them. Years ago, Garth Brooks sang that song, and he thanks God for unanswered prayer. Yeah. God knows what's best for us. God's ultimate goodness for us may not be what we see right away, but it's God's goodness for us. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul prayed three times to God, God, take this thorn out of my flesh. Take this away from me. What did God say? Oh, and my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is seen in your weakness. Right? God doesn't always answer our prayers the way that we want them. God always answers prayer. Yes, no, wait. There's always an answer. Sometimes it's not what we want to see. But thank God that sometimes he says no. Here's a tough one for us. If you have your Bibles out there, turn it to Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 and 6. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 and 6. Because when we think about God's goodness, it's about our benefit. It's about what he gives us. Maybe materially, maybe just a spiritual blessing. But look at here. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 and 6. Read. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastens every son whom he receives. God's goodness is seen in his discipline. You know, if you're a parent, you have a child, and they run into the street, and the first thing you do is you just tan that hide. You're not doing it out of anger. You're doing it because you love that child, and you want them to know, don't do that again. It's very important. It's the same way with God. A mark of God's goodness in our lives as believers is sometimes is our discipline. Because if he allows you to go down a road too long, you're going to damage yourself. We don't see that as goodness, but when we look back, oh yeah, I can see the goodness of the Lord in this. Fifth thing for believers, uniting us with Christ. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20 says this, I have been crucified with Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Get this. That the moment we believe we're united with Christ, he makes us a new creature. We are crucified with him. Our debt is paid. Jesus said it is finished, paid in full. And the moment we believe, we're united with Christ. Here's, look at Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 6. I want you to see this. It says, but God being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Do you get that? That being united to Christ raises us and seats us with him. He's given us life. He's taken us out of death. And that is instantaneous that he unites us with Christ. Number six for believers is this, that he has given us his Holy Spirit and his Word. 2 Peter 2:13 says, his divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Do you get that? That as believers, we have his divine power. It comes through the knowledge of him and the promises that he's going to give us everything we need to live a godly life. Our God is good. Lastly, for us as believers, in Hebrews 2:15 it says that Jesus came to destroy him who has the power of death. He's freed us from slavery. That's Hebrews 2:15. He's given us a hope for the future. You know, when we think about God's goodness, we look out in our driveways and we see a nice car, or we look in the house and we see all these nice things, but God's goodness is not just relegated to temporary stuff. And it's all these things that God has shown us, and even to the unsaved, the way that he continues to sustain and doesn't punish right away. When you look at all of this, what does it mean? It means that God is good. And all the time.
Yeah. God is good.
See, God is good continuously. This is the doctrine of God's goodness. This is what drives us to worship. It lets us see our awesome God, that He is good all the time. Get it? He's good in His mercy. He's good in His justice. He's good in His holiness. He's good in His love. But guess what else? He's good in His wrath. God is good all the time. There's nothing that God does that is not good. Since God is good, get this, He always has our best interests at heart. And how does that make you feel? We may see one thing as good, and this is what I want, but God doesn't see it that way. Oh God, if I won the lottery, just know how good that would be for me. He knows you can't even handle $10. How's He going to give you $10 million? Nothing happens to us that is not for our ultimate good. Take confidence in that. I don't want to play down tragedy, sorrow, you know, unexpected loss. We've all stood beside a grave at one point in time. We understand that. Even we've all prayed earnestly for something and we didn't get it. We have to understand that there's times that God says no. We're not going to see that as we're going through these painful times, the painful process. We won't be able to see it because all we are, we're blinded by our pain. But guess what? There's things that we have to know about our God, that He's always there. He's always in the midst working. In our midst as believers, He's always there. He's always working. It's for our ultimate good. But get this, it's also for His ultimate glory. God sometimes withhold things for us that would not bring Him glory. It's tough when we don't see the goodness as we go through our trials. Often it's not until after we've already been through it that we look back and we say, oh, man, there you were. You were being good. Think about the unluckiest guy in the Bible, Job. Job had all kinds of stuff happening to him, but yet God was still good. Job 23:10, this is what Job says. But He knows the way that I take, and when He has tried me, I shall come out as gold. Everything Job was going through, everything that we're going through right now, God knows the way that we take. We're coming out of something. We don't know where we've been or where we're going, but God knows. It says He knows the way that I take. I may not know what my next decision is. God does. And it's all for our good. What we see in these dark times is blinding light to God. We should draw comfort in that. God knows. Let that comfort your heart. If you're hearing this message and you're not saved, man, run to the cross. Fall upon God's mercy. Because it's not going to last forever. There's going to come a point in time where it stops, and then there's no second chances. God's withholding judgment for right now, but there's going to come a time of reckoning. I urge you, if you're not saved, taste and see the goodness. Taste and see the goodness of God. You need somebody to talk to, send me a message. My phone number is everywhere. If you're saved right now, and now is the time to give thanks to God, for He is good. Let me finish by saying this. God is good
all the time.
And all the time.
Together, days of Elijah.
Time when we get to gather together. Amen.
Amen.